Praise the Lord! Sing to the Lord a new song, His praise in the assembly of His faithful people. Let Israel rejoice in their Maker. Let the people of Zion be glad in their King. Let them praise His name with dancing, and make music to Him with timbrel and harp. For the Lord takes delight in His people. He crowns the humble with victory. Let His faithful people rejoice in this honor, and sing for joy on their beds. May the praise of God be in their mouths.
Together, everybody, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. We humble ourselves before you. Enable us to listen to your word. Speak, for your servants are listening.
Prepare our hearts to worship you.
With us, prepare our hearts.
Our monthly verse for the month of November is found in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 7. Since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 verse 7. Since you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness in the love we have kindled in you, see that you also excel in the grace of giving. What and why we believe? For what do we pray in the fifth request? In the fifth request, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors, which makes it possible for us sincerely to forgive others. We pray that for Christ's sake, God would freely pardon all our sins. For what do we pray in the fifth request? In the fifth request, forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors, which makes it possible for us sincerely to forgive others. We pray that for Christ's sake, God would freely pardon all our sins.
be like when my pain is gone and all the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, well done, well done, my good and faithful one. Welcome to the place where you belong. Well done, well done, my beloved child. You have run the race, and now you're home. Welcome to the place.
Faithful God, have I
before your throne.
Lord, I come before your throne of grace. I find rest in your presence and fullness of joy. In worship and wonder I behold your face, singing what a faith.
Faithful
Heavenly Father, in this moment of online worship, we gather as your image bearers, your children and your bride, expressing our faith and trust in you. As the whole nation is going through disruptive, turbulent, fearful, and uncertain times, we cling to you. As we look to you, we are assured that you are completely sovereign and that this pandemic does not take you by surprise. Lord, you are so great. You are our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of trouble. You alone are our good shepherd. In you we lack nothing. You lead us to green pastures and beside still waters. You restore our anxious and weary souls. Even in the darkest valleys, we will not fear, for you are right here with us. You are always attentive to us. You provide for us, you guide us, you watch behind us, and you go before us. We find safety, comfort, peace, and joy in your guidance and in your word. We cast our cares on you, for you care for us, and nothing can separate us from the love of God. As we go about our daily routines, we ask you to protect our congregation, our city, our nation, and our community in this time of global pandemic. Be merciful to the most vulnerable among us, those most emotionally vulnerable and economically vulnerable. Grant our frontliners extra strength and resilience. Save our local and national government leaders and our business leaders. Grant them wisdom and strength in the midst of the many demands and stress. As a congregation, we pray that you would revive us, fund the passion that is in our hearts. Better yet, transform us, correct us, and prepare us to become who you want us to be. Help us to joyfully and sacrificially be the ears, eyes, hands, and feet of Jesus to each other and to our neighbors. Be with Pastor Vincent Green as he shares to us God's word. Be magnified through our praise and worship. Continue to be magnified as we leave this place with a commitment to apply what we learn in our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Our sermon passage is found in the book of 1 Peter, chapter 3, verses 8 to 17. Finally, all of you, be like-minded, be sympathetic, love one another, be compassionate and humble. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. For whoever would love life and see good days must keep their tongue from evil and their lips from deceitful speech. They must turn from evil and do good. They must seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Who is going to harm you if you are eager to do good? But even if you should suffer for what is right, you are blessed. Do not fear their threats, do not be frightened, but in your hearts revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect, keeping a clear conscience so that those who speak maliciously against your behavior in Christ may be ashamed of their slander. For it is better if it is God's will to suffer for doing good than for doing evil.
Well, it is good to be able to come to you again today and be able to come to you on this Sunday morning and present another passage from the book of 1 Peter. We've been in this study of the book of 1 Peter, and Pastor Billy has asked me to preach this morning to you a passage from 1 Peter chapter 3. And we're going to start in verse 8 and go through verse 17. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 through verse 17. That's our passage for this morning. When you think about the church that Peter writes to, he talks about them being scattered throughout Asia Minor, and that they were in various cities and places in Asia Minor. And as you read this book, it's very clear that the church was suffering persecution. They were suffering for their faith in Christ. They were suffering because of their stand for Christ, their commitment to Christian values, to Christian teaching, their commitment to the Bible. That was what they were being persecuted for. It's one of those things where you stand for Christ, you promote the gospel, you stand for truth, you live by the scriptures. And there are those who do not like it. There are those who hate you for that. There are those who will attack you in some kind of way. Maybe they just ridicule you, or that you may not get that job promotion that you were hoping for, or that you were thinking that you were a good fit for having. Maybe it's your friends would turn away from you. Sometimes they may physically harm you. There are governments these days, I think, that are trying to enact laws and regulations that would hinder the church and hinder Christians from being able to fully promote the gospel. The Christians in these churches that Peter is writing to, they're suffering persecution because of their faith. They're suffering hardship because of that. And you could go back and read the history of what they faced, but I mean, some went to the lion's den where they died and lions chewed them up for dinner. Some lost their head, like the Apostle Paul would lose his head for his faith in Christ. Others were criminally incarcerated or crucified and treated like a criminal because of their faith in Christ. If you're going to stand for Christ, it's not going to be easy. If you're going to stand for Christ, it's not going to be easy in this world. That's for sure. And Peter's writing this letter to them. And he's been talking about various things. But when we get to this section of the book, he really gets to the heart of the matter. And in the focus for this particular passage is on how are you going to really respond to this? I mean, if you had to look your persecutor in the eye, if you had to look right at them, how would you respond to them? Would you let them have it? You know? Would you say, oh, you know what? I can fight you. You want to give it to me? I'll give it back. What would you do? How would you respond? That's what Peter's addressing in this passage that is before us. It's the proper biblical response. The proper biblical response went to those who persecute you. Remember what Jesus said? Bless those who persecute you. Give them a blessing. Pray for them that despitefully abuse you, treat you with evil. The Old Testament would say, don't do evil for evil. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. But what's the proper biblical response? That is what Peter wants to address here in this passage. And it's very, very practical, but it's very intriguing. Notice what he says here. Let me read verses 8 through verse 17 just to give us a setting for our time this morning in God's Word. Peter says, Finally, all of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For, as the Old Testament says, whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet, do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. When we think about this passage and what Peter says here, he lays it out very directly, very succinctly. He doesn't mix words. He doesn't add words here. He gets to the point very quickly, and he wants to address that issue of what should be our response when we face persecution, when we're the recipient of the attack of those who do not care for Christ. Because when they look at us, they see Christ. They see Christ in us. They see our standing in Christ's doctrine. They see our standing in the love of Christ, the truth of Christ, the hope that Christ brings. And it brings us joy, but to them, it drives them crazy. And they don't know what to do with it. And they don't know how to respond to it. And so they may attack, ridicule, like I said before. And what Peter tries to do here, he tries to give the Christians encouragement. He tries to give them an understanding of what they need to do, of how they should respond when that persecution comes. It's at the moment of the persecution. How are you going to respond? How are you going to react? There's basically it's a two-pronged attack here. It's like two sides of a coin. Number one. He starts here in verse 8. He says, finally. So the word finally, he's beginning to wrap up his letter, even though it will go for a little while. All of you. So he's beginning to talk to all of them. No matter your status in life, no matter how rich or poor, no matter your position in the church, all of you. And he gives them a little list of commands. Have unity of mind, have sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. And then he says, do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, do that which Jesus says. Bless. Bless them. Give them a blessing. Don't give them a cursing. Give them a blessing. Now think about this. You're being persecuted for your standing Christ. You're being persecuted because you hold to the gospel. You're being persecuted because you're being attacked for your faith. And how are you going to respond to that? Well, Peter says you need to have the right, proper, biblical attitude. Jesus would talk about this when he said, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So it starts with the actions, the words, and the deeds that are done are a reflection upon the status of the heart. See what I'm saying? That's just basic Bible 101. And Peter taps into that truth and he says, you need to be unified of mind. You need to have sympathy. You need to have brotherly love, a tender heart, a humble mind. Don't repay evil for evil that's done to you, but on the contrary, bless. If you do repay evil for evil done to you, that's cursing. That's saying, I curse you. And Peter says, you can't do that. You remember Peter? When they came to take Jesus, he took the sword out and swacked off the guy's ear. I don't think he was aiming for the ear, but that's what he took off. And Jesus said, you take up the sword, you die by the sword. Peter's speaking from experience here. He knows what he's saying. He's been the recipient of persecution. He's been the recipient of it for many, many years. Just read the book of Acts. Read about how many times the either religious leaders or the Roman guards or someone did not like Peter for who he was and the truth that he held to. Peter knows what it's like and what it means to lash back, to attack back. And he says, finally, let me tell all of you, when it comes to responding to those who persecute you, you respond to them with a biblical attitude. What does that look like? Well, have unity of mind. Understand truth and follow it. All of you, be unified in understanding what the truth is. Have sympathy. Hey, yeah, you're going through a hard time. You're the recipient of persecution, but you have Christ. That person does not. You mean to tell me I need to be sympathetic to my persecutors? Yes. It's not the normal reaction. It's not the initial reaction that you would want to have. The last thing you want to do is give brotherly love. That's the idea of tender-hearted love. He even says, have a tender heart. It's a love that flows from a heart that's tender and looks at the person as better than themselves. I mean, this is not how you... Peter, this would be similar to what Peter would say of how we should treat each other. But that's not what Peter's saying here. The point he's trying to make is this is how you respond to your persecutors. Those who attack you, those who ridicule you, those who want to have your lunch, those who really want to come after you because of your faith in Christ. You need to have unity of mind. You need to be sympathetic towards them. Show brotherly love. Have a tender heart. Have a humble mind. My goodness. Peter, we could look at this and say, read this and say, Peter, you're one to speak for this. How many times, Peter, do you want to take up the sword and let them have it? And Peter said, yeah, every time I did that, I was wrong. I let the anger in my heart get the best of me. You gotta respond this way. And what you want to do, your normal human reaction, is going to be repay evil done to you. Repay them evil, give them back evil for the evil they have done to you. Or if they reviled you, you revile them back. But you can't do that. Take a look at Christ when he went on the cross. Take a look at what they did to Christ and how he responded. Repaying evil for evil would be looking at it from the deeds that they do, the physical beating or the physical acts that they do against you. The reviling here would be how they speak to you while they're beating you up. No matter what they say, no matter what they do, you cannot return in kind. You cannot return that in the same measure, in the same way. Otherwise, you are giving a cursing. And Peter says, on the contrary, you need to give a blessing. You mean I got to give a blessing to those who hate me? I got to give a blessing to those who curse me? I got to give a blessing to those who treat me with evil? My goodness. But that's what Peter's saying. That's how we're to respond. this is not easy to do. I mean, we understand it. We would even say amen with what Peter's saying here. But it's not easy to do. But notice what he says. What's the reason for this? For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. You see, the idea of called here is that sovereign call of election where Christ places you in his body. You're now a child of God. And when Christ called you and brought you into the fellowship of believers, he did that for a reason, so that you could obtain a blessing. You know what your blessing is going to be? Go back to 1 Peter 1. Look at what he says in 2 Peter chapter 3. You've been born again for a new hope, a living hope. See, the world out there is dead. They're going to die in their sins. They're going to receive cursing for the rest, for eternity, if they don't come to Christ. You're going to receive an eternal blessing. You and I are going to, we have an inheritance that's undefiled, that doesn't fade away. It's reserved in heaven for us. That's the blessing that Peter's talking about. And we've been called to it. We've been commissioned to it. It's ours. And so knowing your future will help you today respond in the right manner. Respond with a biblical attitude. What Peter's addressing, having unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, tender heart, humble mind, not giving a cursing, but rather giving a blessing. These are biblical attitudes. They start from within the heart, and they manifest out in the way you speak and the way you act. And that's what Peter's getting at. They're going to come at you with reviling. They're going to come at you with anger and with resentment and with maybe hitting you with their fist. You can't be like them. You can't respond like they treat you. You have to respond differently. You have to give a blessing. You have to be tenderhearted. You have to be kind. You have to be patient. You have to be loving. They don't know the Lord. And you never know how the Lord may use you to reach your persecutors. I've told you about, I think, at least I've mentioned this in other places, where if you go back and look at the Apostle Paul, when he was under house arrest, he was chained to a Roman guard. And he had a chain around his arm 24 hours a day. And the Roman guards that were chained to him did 6-hour shifts. So every 24 hours, that was 4 different Roman guards. Each guard, one guard for 6 hours. And you would say, poor Paul, he's chained to a Roman guard. No privacy, no time of his own. Think of it this way. Poor Roman guard. He had to hear the gospel for 6 hours. He had to go and see Paul visit Christians and preach. He had to hear it. He had to sit there and listen to it. And can you imagine the conversations that Paul had with the Roman guard? The Roman guard is technically his persecutor. And that's why Paul would say in the book of Philippians, there are those in the Praetorian Guard. The Praetorian Guard is those guards. And they greet you. Why do you think that happened? Some of those Praetorian guards came to faith in Christ. Came to faith in Christ. He said, don't repay evil for evil, or reviling for reviling. But on the contrary, bless. For to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. For whoever desires to love life and see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil and his lips from speaking deceit. Let him turn away from evil and do good. Let him seek peace and pursue it. Because the eyes of the Lord are all the righteous, and he hears, and his ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. This is precious. He's quoting the Old Testament, and he's saying, remember what the Old Testament said? Whoever desires to love life and see good days, then what's the path for that? Keep your tongue from evil. Keep your lips from speaking deceit. So that means no reviling. turn away from the evil, do good. That talks about the deeds. Seek peace, pursue peace, even with your persecutors. Why? Because the Lord's eyes are on the righteous. He hears the prayers of the righteous. Don't worry, he knows who the evil are. And he's against them. You see, you don't give the cursing. Let God do that. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. What Peter is challenging us to do here is if we're going to have to respond to our persecutors, and we will, we'll have to respond, we need to respond with a biblical attitude. The right kind of heart that manifests itself out in the right kind of speech and the right kind of deeds. That's how you respond when you're being persecuted. You know, maybe somebody at your work, and you know, in today's day, you may be working from home and your company's closed down, or you have to do it differently, and you know, maybe you're out of work, but, or maybe you think about your neighbors or someone who just may be angry at you, and because of your faith in Christ, because of who you are, and because of how you live, and they don't understand it. Maybe they're going through stresses and they're taking it out on you. No telling. No telling what's going on. But you got to respond biblically. Got to have a biblical attitude. Got to have a kind heart, a tender heart. And it's in that moment when the persecution comes, that's where you got to dig deep and find it. That's when that kind heart and biblical attitude has to manifest itself. At that moment and at that time. Otherwise, you may respond in the wrong way. And you'll regret it later. This is what we're to do. This is how we're to live. This is how we're to live our life, especially when we're going through the heat of being persecuted for our faith. It's not easy. It's not easy not to be able to meet for church, isn't it? How many months have we been doing this online thing? I mean, when is it going to end? You know, an invisible virus has the potency to do all of this. I've heard some reports that this may keep going for another year. Till the end of 2021, I don't think nobody has any idea how long this is going to go. It's totally changed the world. But we got to keep moving forward. No matter if we think the government's against us or not, we have to respond with a biblical attitude, proper biblical attitude. But Peter doesn't stop there. It's one thing to challenge us to respond with a proper biblical attitude, and we should. But you know what? You know what gives us the motivation to do that, to do the first one? There's another element here that Peter addresses. That's in verses 13 through verse 17. But he wants to give us encouragement to do the first thing by talking about the second thing. Not only are we should have a proper biblical attitude, and respond that way to our persecutors, we need to have another element. There's another element here that you got to think about. Let me show you these verses. I'll show you what this is. Okay, so verse 13. Now, think about it this way. Who is there to harm you? You say, well, they're the persecutors. They could kill me, chop off my head, feed me to the lions. But think about it. We all know we're going to die someday, right? We're not going to live forever in this body. It's not going to happen. We're getting older, physically weaker. It's kind of what happens, right? Read the book of Ecclesiastes, especially the last chapter. It's all about dying and how your body goes frail and gets weaker and older and can't do as much as you used to. Just a fact of life. But what Peter's talking about is, who really can harm you? You may physically die. But if you are in Christ, no one can take that away. You are eternally secure in Christ. So who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? Normally, if you do that which is good, nobody's going to harm you. But there may be some who try. And there may be some who come after you. Can they really harm you ultimately? No. But even if they seek your physical harm. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake. Even if you would lose your physical life. Because of your stance for Christ and of your belief in Him, even if you would lose your physical life because of righteousness' sake and should suffer because of righteousness' sake, because of Christ, you still will be blessed. Think about it. Don't just look at the here and now. Look to the future. Look to the future. So don't have any fear of them. Don't be troubled. You know, you could sit there and go, oh, they're going to come after me. They're going to come after me. They're going to get me. They're going to chop off my head. I'm going to run. You know, don't fear them. Don't be troubled. No need to worry. No need for anxiety. But here's what you do. In your heart, you honor Christ the Lord as holy. You be resolute. The point Peter's making is, hey, don't have any fear of them. Don't be troubled, no matter how big they are, no matter how sharp their sword is. The worst they can do is end your physical life, absent in the body, present with the Lord. You have, and here's the key, confidence in God. You want to know how you can respond with a biblical attitude? You have confidence in God. You trust your life with Him. And that's what eternal life is, right? You have eternal life. We haven't seen it yet. We haven't seen the new heavens and the new earth yet. But it's coming. We know it's a coming. And you always be prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason, for the hope that is in you. You see, what is in you? Hope. Who gave you that hope? Christ did. What hope do you have? A hope of an eternal future. That's the hope you have. So you be ready to tell them the confidence that you have in Christ. They may think you're crazy. They may think you're loony. They may not understand it. But you stand ready is the idea. You always be prepared to make an apologetic, a defense to anyone. You say, here I stand, this is who I am. You may not agree with it, you may not like it, but this is who I am. You're not going to change me. I'm going to stand for Jesus, stand for Christ. I'm not going to renounce. But you do it that way. You give that defense, not with anger, but you do it with gentleness and respect. But you're showing the confidence that you have in Christ. You're manifesting. It's not just be confident. I'm saying manifest that confidence out to them. Show them that you're confident in Christ. Show them that you have a hope. Show them that you're going to take a stand. That you're not going to change. You're not going to fear. You're not gonna have anxiety or worry or trouble about what the future holds. You're gonna say, listen, I may not know the future. I may not know your heart. I may not know how you can ever come to Christ. I don't know why you really want to persecute me. I may not understand too much, but I'll tell you this. Nothing's gonna sway me. I'm not gonna be fearful of anything. I'm gonna stand resolute in Christ. And even if you chop my head off, I'll get to see Him face to face. Always be gentle. Always show respect. You got to have a good conscience. You see, they're going to slander you. They're going to revile your good behavior in Christ. They're going to speak evil about you. They're going to make up that slander is making up lies about you that are not true. Reviling you is just open derision. It's just, you know, them coming after you. And when you're slandered and when they revile you because of your good behavior in Christ, they are going to be the ones put to shame. Remember, Christ is going to take care of it. And we don't know the timing of that. We don't know how he will, but we just got to put it in his hands. Because what's the principle of the matter? On what basis can you have confidence? It is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than for doing evil. You see, if you do evil, you should suffer for that, because doing evil is wrong. And you have to pay the consequences. But if you do good and do not deserve persecution, but still suffer for it, if that would be what God would want, then gladly go through it. Do it with responding in a biblical attitude, and do it with responding with biblical confidence in Christ. They cannot take away your salvation. They cannot take away what Christ has given you. They can't take away your eternal inheritance. They can't take away the peace that you have with him. They cannot take away the joy that is in your heart. They can try, but they can't take it away. You possess that for all eternity. And no matter what you face, and no matter what you go through, and no matter how bad it would be, you can do it with the right attitude and confident in Christ that he holds you right in his hands. And if your persecutors ask, why are you so joyful? Why are you I'll tell you exactly why. I'll tell you why I've put my trust in Christ. I'll tell you why I hope in him. I'll tell you why he is the center of my world, because I am a rotten, rotten sinner needing salvation. And he is the only perfect one. He is our Lord. He is our God. He is my creator. And he is my savior. And he is the only one that can save me. And save me from my sin. Save me from myself. That's how we respond. That's how we respond to those who persecute us. Those who would desire to harm us, to do evil to us. That's how we respond. We respond with a biblical, proper biblical attitude. We're sympathetic. We show brotherly love. We have a tender heart that manifests itself out with humility and kindness and blessing people instead of cursing them. We also show biblical confidence in the fact that we know who we are in Christ. And if anybody ever asks us why we are who we are, we can tell them with passion, zeal, affirmation. They may not agree with us. They may hate us for it. But we know who we are in Christ, and no one can take that away. So how do you respond to those who persecute you? Have a proper biblical attitude. Show love, kindness, humility. Show respect, gentleness. And do that with confidence in Christ. Manifest to those people that you're confident in Christ. Don't go out there with the martyr complex, you know. I'm ready to die for Christ. I know you are. Just be real. If it's your time to go and be with the Lord, you'll go. The Lord will bring you home. But you can't show fear, even though you may be fearful. You can't show anxiety. You got to show confidence. You got to manifest that. That's how you live in a world that would want to treat you with evil. You don't respond with evil done to you. You don't respond with evil. You respond with Christ-like love. Because that's how he commands us to live. But we have confidence in him because of what he has done for us and who he is. You know, one day we'll have a new heaven and a new earth to live in. And Peter talks about that in 2 Peter 3. And when he mentions that, he talks about that. But then when he says all about, after he describes that, he says, knowing this is your future, that you're going to have a new heaven, new earth. It's all the bad stuff's going to go away. And it's, you got a new heaven, new earth where there's holiness and righteousness. And that's your eternity and that's your future forever and ever and ever. What kind of people should you be now is the point he wants to make. The kind of people that we should be is those who show love to those who hate us, those we should show kindness to those who persecute us. We should give a blessing to those who want to revile us, spit on us, ridicule us, slander us. And God will take care of it. We can be confident in him. What a wonderful passage. What a wonderful truth. If you're experiencing persecution or just hardship and you think the world's out to get you, well, they are. The world doesn't like what you believe in. It's counter to all of them. And they may attack you for it. But you stand resolute in Christ, never wavering, never fearing, because Christ is totally got your back, and he has got you right where he wants you, and he will lead you and guide you to do that which he would have you do. Isn't that a wonderful truth? Let's pray. Dear God, we do give you thanks today. We do give you thanks for your truth, for your word, that when we face persecution, when we face those who do not agree with us, who do not understand what we believe, who do not understand the Bible, who want to attack the Bible, attack us for it, and attack true Christianity. Lord, help us to respond in the right way, the biblical way. Follow your pattern. Follow what Peter tells us to do here, because we can have confidence in you, and we can give an answer to those who attack us and those who would attack you. You told us that if they hate you, they'll hate us. And that is true. We've seen that. But Lord, you also tell us how to show love in response to that. Help us to continue to do that. We give you thanks and pray in Jesus' name.
If you are a regular member of UCC Church and you wish to give through bank deposit or bank transfer, here are our bank details. Kindly email deposit slip or transfer confirmation receipt to write to uccc@gmail.com. Let me repeat, write to uccc@gmail.com. UCC Church, we will have our online Bible study via Zoom app every second and fourth Friday of the month. See you. Our speaker for next Sunday is Pastor Keith Ibrahim.
Unto him that hath thou givest evermore abundantly, Lord, I live because thou livest, therefore give more life to me. Therefore speed me in the race, therefore let me grow in grace. Therefore speed me in the race, therefore let all thy work, O Master, strengthen every downward root. Only do thou ripen faster, more and more thy pleasant fruit. Purge me, prune me, myself abase. Only let me grow in grace. Purge me, prune me, self abase. Only let me grow in grace.
We confess the mystery and wonder of God made flesh and rejoice in our great salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord.
With the Father and the Holy Spirit, the Son created all things, sustains all things, and makes all things new.
Truly God, he became truly man. Two natures in one person.
He was born of the Virgin Mary and lived among us.
Crucified, dead, and buried.
He rose on the third day, ascended to heaven, and will come again in glory and judgment.
For us, he kept the law, atoned for sin, and satisfied God's wrath.
He took our filthy rags and gave us his righteous robe.
He is our prophet, priest, and king,
building his church, interceding for us, and reigning over all things.
Jesus Christ is Lord.
We praise his holy name forever. Amen.
Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, for feeding us with your word, and for encouraging us this morning. And now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. In Jesus' name, receive God's blessing. Amen and amen.
May the road rise to meet you. May the wind blow at your back. May the sun shine warmly on your face. May the rain fall softly on your feet. And
our service ends here. Don't forget to answer the survey. We posted the links on the description below. God bless everybody.